Real life, sir.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this neuro-ophthalmology module. We are extremely pleased to have Dr. Satya Khanna as our mentor and lecturer today. Dr. Satya Khanna joins us from Noida. He works presently at JP Hospital in Noida. We go back long way. We were together in 1995 at Netralaya, and he has been one of the pioneers of a lot of new work at Shankaranetralaya when he was there and outside of it. He brought out the very famous Shankaranetralaya Atlas of Neuro-Ophthalmology, and he was the force behind it. Last year during the lockdown, he coordinated and actually conducted one of the best known neuro-ophthalmology meetings last year, where he had faculty from all over the world. And he's a passionate teacher and a great clinician. Satya, over to you.
Oh, thank you, Rashmin. So should I start with my presentation right away?
Yes, sir, sure.
Okay. Here goes. So the topic today is disc edema evaluation as well as evaluation of disc.
Yes,
it is full screen. No?
Yes.
Yeah, this is full screen. Yeah, okay. So, so I know that this presentation comes way down in the line of neuro-ophthalmology presentations at iFocus this year. So I think most of you have been exposed to all the other neuro-ophthalmic presentations, including investigations, and this would seem a little out of place, but I would look at it like a revision, and you could ask any questions that you want to ask related to any of the topics in neuro-ophthalmology as I keep showing you some slides. And I've already received a couple of questions before this talk today, and let me just jump into the talk, and I will probably be posing a few questions to all of you, and you've got to, you know, whoever is online right now and can interact has to give me answers. So you've got to do it in a rapid fire fashion so that we can move on. I have a large number of slides, but you can stop me wherever you want in between. And now we'll move on to the next slide here. So the important thing here is that we are looking at evaluation of the disc edema or disc pallor. So the important thing in neuro-ophthalmology is a detailed history. So without history, you don't know what this disc edema means. You don't know why it has happened. You don't know where is the lesion. You don't know what is the lesion. So you need a definite and detailed history. So spend as much time as you can. Ask your referring ophthalmologist if required. Ask the attendant. Ask the patient. And if required, anybody else who has, you know, got any stake in this, to give you more details about the history of the patient. This cannot be emphasized more. Check for RAPD. So that is to find out if it is a unilateral optic nerve lesion or if it is an asymmetric optic nerve lesion. Check the best corrected visual acuity, not just any visual acuity, not unaided alone, not with glasses alone. Check the best corrected acceptance of the patient for distance as well as near. It has a big role in defining what kind of optic neuropathy it is. Check the color vision, because it segregates or differentiates between optic neuritis and the rest of the optic neuropathies in a big way, if the history is in favor of optic neuritis. So this is a very important test in the OPD. Keep Ishihara color vision charts ready with you all the time. Keep multiple copies of Ishihara vision charts with you. Keep a copy with the optometrist, keep it with you, keep it with your colleague, but you should have a proper Ishihara color vision chart. Study the morphology of the disc. Now that is what all this presentation is about. And we'll go back and forth between different kinds of optic neuropathies to find out what morphology represents which condition. Don't forget to check the blood pressure, because the blood pressure will differentiate between disc edema due to raised intracranial pressure and simply due to raised blood pressure. do the visual fields, do the OCT and the fundus photography as and when required for different kinds of disc edema or disc pallor. So we've all read this. Now let us recap what are the 10 signs of true disc edema. Now there are 5 mechanical signs and 5 vascular signs. The mechanical signs, the structure of the optic disc, you would notice there is a loss of the cup or there is a reduction in the size of the cup as compared to the other optic nerve. There could be elevation of the disc. It could be the center of the disc. It could be the margins of the disc. It could be the entire disc. There could be blurring of margins of the disc. A portion of the margin, it could be 360 degrees, it could be temporal margin or the nasal margin. There could be a nerve fiber layer edema, which is spilling over into the peripapillary area. Then there could be folds, that is retinal folds, which are known as Patton's lines, or choroidal folds. So all these are mechanical signs. Now let's go on to vascular signs. Specifically look for hyperemia of the disc, which means there is some kind of a venous congestion there. There is venous dilation or not. There is venous tortuosity or not. Look for peripapillary hemorrhages, a few scattered hemorrhages on the disc or just around the disc. Look for nerve fiber layer infarcts or cotton wool spots, again, just around the disc. And look for exudates. Now, important thing is these are signs of true disc edema. But when you're looking for these, please ensure that you look at the entire fundus also and search for such hemorrhages, cotton wool spots or exudates anywhere in the fundus, because that will help you correlate with the etiology or will help you correlate or find out the exact diagnosis. So just examining the disc is not going to give you the correct picture. Okay, so again, coming back to the same thing, we know how we evaluate an optic nerve head, how we look at the optic disc, we look at the margin, we look at the cup, and we look at the neuroretinal rim. The neuroretinal rim is the most important part in this whole story, because in neuro-ophthalmology, the rim is the one which becomes thinner or becomes pale. And so the rim is the one which has to be looked at carefully. And then you look at the blurring of the nerve fiber layer or the margins of the disc. Edema, which produces blurring in one quadrant, means something else, which produces blurring all over the disc means something else. So let's go into that now. Don't forget that you can look at the optic disc and the optic nerve head with direct ophthalmoscope, indirect ophthalmoscope, 90D, 78D. So you have various methods and all of them have filters. So learn to use the green filter, because that helps you find out this kind of subtle nerve fiber layer edema, the blurring along the disc margin. So definitely helps you to look for structures underlying this, we will see. And then second thing is look at this nerve fiber layer. Look at the nice glistening nerve fiber layer on the superior and inferior aspect of the optic disc. All these arrowheads which show you the nerve fiber layer. This is a normal peripapillary nerve fiber layer, but right on the disc, you can see there's a blurring of the margin. And then we go on to this picture. So after all this introduction, let us now leave it open. Can anybody tell me what are you looking at here?
So with the clear media, the disc margins look blurred.
Yes.
And the cup, I'm not able to figure out the cup size, sir.
Correct. So there is. Agreed. There's no cup. There's hardly any cup. You can't make out a cup. Okay.
So it is suggestive of disc edema.
Okay.
The DDs could be true sensor.
Okay, so now you mentioned two words. You said it is suggestive of disc edema and you also said that it could be Drusen. So normally when you have disc Drusen, in majority of the cases, it is asymptomatic and you do not have any disc edema, right?
Yes.
Now, but you do have an elevation of the optic nerve head. So yes, I agree with you. This is a 2D picture and you will not be able to make out the elevation of the optic nerve head. But yes, if you find this blurring of the disc margin all around, it definitely is not a round and clear margin, right? And here also it is not a round and clear margin. There is a irregular kind of margin, which is all blurred. Now, what you notice along with that is these spots which are marked by the arrow here. What do you think are these? Divya?
Hypopigmented elevations.
Okay, subtle yellow colored excretions that you see there. There's probably underlying the disc, which is causing the elevation. Yeah, making it look elevated, right? Yeah. Now the important thing here is there are no cotton wool spots, no hemorrhages, no exudates. In fact, even the vessels, they are not blurred or obscured. You can see the vessels clearly all along. Am I right? You're able to see every single vessel and follow it over the disc. So yes. What here is that there is something which is kind of elevating the disc from behind, from below. So you're right, this is optic disc drusen. And these patients are usually asymptomatic. This drusen can get exposed over a period of decades, and then it may cause symptoms by compression of the nerve fibers. All right. So this is basically a case of a pseudo disc edema. So pseudo papal edema, because both eyes are there. So pseudo papal edema. Okay. This is not true disc edema. So let's go to the next set. Is this showing true disc edema or pseudo papal edema or pseudo disc edema? Divya?
Sir, the margins appear blurred and
yes.
The cup disc ratio is not really appreciated, sir. The
yes.
Vessels look, the veins look slightly tortuous.
Okay.
Congested.
Yeah.
So it could be a true disc edema, sir.
Okay, so when you look at this first two slides, yes, it looks like as if there is a true disc edema here. Okay, maybe, may not be, I'm not going to deny that, but you look at this investigation at the bottom. What does this show you?
There is a hyperreflective shadow at the optic disc area, sir.
Yeah, there is a hyperreflective lesion at the optic nerve. And this lesion, which is so bright, which is on right... Yeah. On the optic nerve head in this patient is actually an optic disc drusen. Okay, now if they had shown the A scan along with it, you would have seen that there is a elevation and there's a big spike at this point. Okay,
yes.
Now so this can give you a false impression. So just to keep in mind that if you are confused, go for investigations like this. For example, you go for the ultrasound. And it's a simple OPD-based investigation and you will find out the optic disc drusen. If you are not able to confirm it, if your scan quality is not too good and you still want to confirm it, and then you can go for a plain CT scan. A plain CT scan will also pick up calcification at the optic nerve head, which is suggestive of drusen. Okay, so that's drusen. Let's keep that aside now. Let's go to, what is this? This is right and left eye of the same patient. Anybody else?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Yes, Risha.
So here in this, sir, the disc margins are not clear and the cup is also not very visible.
Yes.
But again, the vasculature seems a little abnormal since there is, there are little dilated veins, but not, they're not, there's no compression or there's no hemorrhage or cotton wool spots or exudation. So
yeah,
again,
yeah,
this is well most described. Likely.
Yeah. So I would say that these veins are tortuous. Okay. You see this, this is zigzag. It's all of these veins are tortuous. Okay. But you have the same picture on both sides. And actually, this was a child who had no symptoms, 6x6 vision, and this was the appearance from birth. Okay. So this is
optic nerve hypoplasia.
The congenital crowded disc. This is what this is. All right. So this has no clinical implications. The patient does not have any visual symptoms or signs. Okay. Now let's go to true disc edema again. So we saw the mild disc edema. Here we are looking at moderate disc edema. Look at the margins and you can see that there is edema almost all around. You can see nerve fiber layer is thickened. You can see it's very prominent here. So there is edema all around. You can see tortuosity of the vessels, right? Then you can see that some of these vessels are obscured. Can you make out here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all these are obscured. So basically it is true disc edema. The cup is hardly seen. Okay. And you can see this kind of, if you can appreciate this, there's a little elevation here on the margin, which is basically elevation and nerve fiber layer thickness. Okay. Right. Now coming to severe disc edema. So there are add-on features now. I told you peripapillary, you can see cotton wool spots, and then you can see a splinter hemorrhage here. Quite tortuous vessels. You can see all of these vessels are so tortuous. So many vessels are obscured. You can hardly make out any of the vessels on the disc except this major one or this one. But on the margin, almost all of them are obscured. Right? So this is severe disc edema. Okay. Right. Now, another example of a severe disc edema, you can see that the optic cup is missing. You can't see it. That the vessels are so tortuous. The margins are absent. You cannot see anything. Then these nerve fiber layer is thickened and you can see there is elevation of the entire disc, which is much elevated compared to the rest of the retina, which is out of focus. When you take fundus photos, the rest of the retina is totally out of focus because you are focused on the disc. And then you can see all these, there is congestion and this disc is hyperemic, and that is because of the increased capillary vascularity here. So another investigation, when in doubt between mild, moderate or severe disc edema, is to do first you do a red-free picture and then you do an angiography and you will see leak from the disc head. So this kind of a leak, a blurring of the margin, the leak from the optic nerve head is confirmatory of optic disc edema. This is not required in most of the cases. This is only for subtle optic disc edema. If you are unable to differentiate, even after doing the OCT, you are in a big doubt whether it is true disc edema or not, you can do the angiography. So coming to the OCT, these days OCT is extremely useful in all cases of optic neuropathy. So please do and mention optic OCT in all optic nerve cases, because OCT will tell you the elevation of the optic nerve head margin. It will tell you what kind of space is there under the optic disc. And it will also tell you whether the Bruch's membrane complex is normal or is it upturned or downturned. And that helps you differentiate between papillitis or papilledema. And it also is used in follow-ups when you see the OCT showing the optic nerve head becoming flatter and flatter, which confirms that the disc edema is reducing. Plus, it also helps you to see any fluid tracking down into the macula and if the macula is normal or not. And so for basically differentiating the etiology as well as for confirming improvement with medication with treatment. Okay. So now disc edema can be unilateral or bilateral. The etiology of bilateral disc edema, the important one, the emergency situation is papilledema. This requires emergent investigations the same day, because you could be missing an intracranial tumor. You could be missing any kind of an intracranial pathology which is causing increased intracranial pressure and papilledema in both the eyes, or asymmetric papilledema in some cases. So that is the most important. I put hypertensive retinopathy here. And why is that so important? Because in all such patients, please do the blood pressure check, because that will rule out other causes and will probably help you when coming to hypertensive retinopathy, which is very much more common than papilledema. Then diabetic papillopathy, which is not so common, but yes, it is kept in the differential diagnosis. Pseudopapilledema, we already talked about. So don't use the term papilledema unless you mean it. So if you see disc edema on both sides, please say bilateral disc edema. Okay, and then once you have confirmed the increased intracranial pressure by other signs and by investigations, then you can call it papilledema. Then laboratory confirmation, like with the lumbar puncture and of course MRI. And papilledema, as I told you, is an emergency. Friesen gave the classification of grades of papilledema. Grade 0 to grade 5. Grade 0 is a normal optic disc with no obscuration of peripapillary nerve fiber layer, no halo. Grade 1, there is a C-shaped halo of the retinal nerve fiber layer, edema, obscuring the peripapillary retina. Grade 2, the halo is now circumferential, all around. There is no temporal gap and no vessel obscuration. Grade 3, the major vessels are obscured by edema as they leave the disc. And grade 4, the major vessels are now obscured by edema on the optic disc itself. Grade 5 is all vessels are at least partially obscured by edema. So now let's look at this grading again. You see the grade 0, that is always a normal disc. Grade 1, it looks like a C-shaped halo around the disc. Then the other two, going back to this so that we can recall it, the two, 1 and 2, the difference is between a C-shaped halo and a circumferential edema. And 3, 4, 5, the difference is basically the major vessels obscured at the margin versus obscured on the optic disc, and grade 5, all are partially obscured. So look at this again. So this has a C-shaped halo. This has a circumferential halo of nerve fiber layer edema. This has obscuration of some of the major vessels at the margin of the disc. This is obscuration of vessels on the disc itself. And this, of course, you can't make out anything at all. So this is how the grading is done. For each eye, the grading may be different. So it doesn't mean when you write a grade, it means both sides are the same. It could be asymmetric. So here, as this example shows, you have this kind of a C-shaped halo, but there is also some kind of an obscuration of the major vessels here. So I put it as a right eye 2 to 3, and the third, this left eye seems to be having obscuration all around and also seems to be having a few of these vessels which are obscured. So put it as grade 3. Okay. Any doubts in this? Just going back to this text again. Get into the habit of using the Friesen grades and writing it down. Yeah, any doubts?
Sir, is there any reason behind why there is a blurring of nasal disc margin seen first? Or is it always that nasal disc margin is blurred in papilledema?
Yeah. Good question. No. So this gives you the false impression that, you know, the disc edema will start nasally and will go on to the entire disc margin. No. Nothing like that. This is not the order of events that happens, nothing like that. You can have a case presenting to you with anything. It can have a sudden onset papilledema, okay, because of maybe a head injury with cerebral edema, and then you can get a grade 3 or 4. All right, so it doesn't have to go through all these grades. So there is no specific reason why it will happen this way or that way. It all depends on the morphology of the disc and the amount of pressure behind. Okay. Right then. So what does this, why do you think it is papilledema? First and foremost, in any case of disc edema, do the investigation that is right next to you. That is the visual field test. So you will get enlarged blind spots in mild disc edema or early disc edema, and which can even sometimes in severe disc edema, you would just get very large blind spots, but no other visual or visual field effect. That tells you when it is bilateral, that tells you that this is papilledema. This differentiates it from optic neuritis, from AIVN, from all other causes, because there will be no other visual field effect. But when you have enlarged blind spots along with other visual field defects like constriction of the peripheral fields, or if you start getting a sudden loss of vision in one eye, and then you can get an altitudinal scotoma, then you know that it is a complicated case. It is an advanced stage of papillary and which needs to be treated surgically. So that is one we are looking at it. See this example. You have a patient who had papilledema in both the eyes and he had enlarged blind spots along with which he has constricted visual fields. Now, you cannot just give this patient medication and keep following him up. This is the kind of patient who will require optic nerve sheath fenestration. Once you have confirmed that it is papilledema which is causing this, and that will help relieve the pressure and also may help in improvement of the visual fields. Okay. Let's look at this case. Now this patient, so as I was telling you, papilledema can have a large number of causes. We know that anything ranging from cerebral edema to metastasis, to intracranial space occupying lesion like meningiomas and astrocytomas, and all these can cause, and even you can have posterior fossa tumors, you can have a CP angle tumor, which can cause the raised intracranial pressure causing papilledema. So a large number of causes, and that's why the most important investigation for a case of papilledema is an MRI brain with contrast to look for the space occupying lesion. And the lesion could be anywhere. Papilledema is not a localizing sign. Okay, the lesion can be anywhere causing a raised intracranial pressure. Okay, what is this? Anybody? Divya, Isha, anyone? Rolika?
So with the clear media, the disc margins look normal and cup disc ratio is made out. And
I differ a little bit there. The margin is slightly blurred. Slightly blurred, yes.
Yellowish lesions with irregular margins are seen, obscuring the vessel, suggestive of cottonwool spots.
Oh, yes. Okay. All these red arrows, they are showing us cottonwool spots. And
the macula, the foveal reflex is looking very dull, sir.
Yes.
There are some yellowish lesions with well-defined borders around the macula, suggestive of hard exudates, sir.
Very good, very good. Here you can see, I'll go back, sorry. This you can see there are hard exudates here, right? So what do you think this is? Is this papilledema? That's my question.
It could be papilledema also, sir. Or it could be neuroretinitis.
Okay, wait. You're jumping the gun. So it's not neuroretinitis because it is quite, severe in both eyes and quite, involving the optic nerve as well as the retina, agreed, but it is there on both sides. And if I give you the history that now this patient had headaches, agreed, he had some blurring of vision, but he had near 6.9, 6.6 vision. Okay. But this picture where you have so much of cotton wool spots, what does that suggest?
Sir, it could be any inflammatory cause, or it could be even hypertensive retinopathy.
Right. So as I told you earlier, do check the blood pressure for these patients in the OPD, because this could be, and this is hypertensive retinopathy. Okay. So as you can see, the patient may have headaches just like in case of papilledema. And the patient may have slight blurring or no blurring of vision like in papilledema. And the patient may have these exudates tracking down from the disc towards the fovea. But in papilledema, you have exudates tracking down the from the disc to the fovea when it is severe disc edema, not like this. Now, this kind of picture where you have so many cotton wool spots, and you have more cotton wool spots than hemorrhages, it goes in favor of hypertensive retinopathy. So the blood pressure was extremely high. Usually the diastolic runs up above 100, and that is the cause for this sudden onset blurring of vision or a routine finding when patient complains of headache and comes to your OPD. This is another example of hypertensive retinopathy where you can see what is happening. Those exudates which we were talking to you about, this is an incomplete macular star. So that is an important sign of exudates which are tracking down from this side, from the disc towards the fovea, not exactly due to inflammation of these nerve fiber layers, but rather coming from here. That is why it is an incomplete macular star. And then you can see there are so many cotton wool spots all over the place. And that is suggestive of hypertensive retinopathy, and the blood pressure was very high. So always remember to check the blood pressure in such patients. So bilateral disc edema is covered. Let's go to unilateral disc edema. We have NAION, we have optic neuritis, neuroretinitis, CRVO, and a few of the other not so common conditions. Let's see the differential diagnosis. So if you have a disc edema with a patient who complains of visual loss in one eye, okay? So what are we now looking at? We are looking at the following things. You will do the next investigation to do, let's say the vision is 612 or 618 or 624. The next investigation that you do is a visual field. And if you get this, now could you tell me the difference, anyone? If you get the field defect on the left versus the field defect on the right. In the same kind of disc edema.
So the one on the right shows something like a centrosecal scotomasum.
Okay.
The other one shows like an altitudinal defect. So inferior.
Okay. Okay, so what do you think is the etiology in each case?
So I think the right one could be optic neuritis and the left one could be ischemic neuropathy.
Okay, good. That is what I wanted to understand, you to understand, because these are the two most common conditions which will present to you ever in your career. Okay, in the optic nerve head, the optic neuritis and the ischemic optic neuropathy. So this is the kind of pattern that you can get a central scotoma, a centrosecal or a paracentral scotoma. And this you can get typically in optic neuritis on the textbook. But clinically, you can get this in optic neuritis and you can also get it in ischemic optic neuropathy. It is not a rare finding there. The other important thing is this is the altitudinal scotoma, which is much, much more common in ischemic optic neuropathy and occasionally seen in other optic neuropathies. Then comes the arcuate scotoma, which can happen in typically in optic neuritis. And you will have to, if it is a disc edema, then definitely a papillitis case with arcuate scotoma and with or without visual loss. Now, these are the patterns which you should have in your mind when you're looking at visual fields in a patient with disc edema or even with disc pallor, because that will take you back to the original cause, original etiology. Disc pallor case presenting to you with this kind of scotoma will give a suggestion of a post-neuritic optic neuropathy or post-neuritic optic disc pallor, and this kind of altitudinal will suggest an ischemic cause to the optic neuropathy. So can anyone describe this disc?
So there are blurred and elevated disc margins with there's also, I think there's hyperemia to some extent along yes. with, I can see a Patton's line, which is, I mean, the curvilinear line along the, temporal.
This line?
Yes.
Okay, I would say this is a reflection because of the photograph, flash of the photograph. This is the kind of reflection that you're getting.
Okay. And the slight congestion, I mean, there's dilation of the veins.
Oh, yes, that's right. There's a dilatation of the veins. There's a slight tortuosity there. Absence of the cup, right? So this kind of picture can happen in optic neuritis. It can also happen in ischemic optic neuropathy. So don't let it fool you. Look at the history in detail. Is it painful or painless? If it is painful, you're looking at optic neuritis. If it is painless and it is an elderly or 40 plus age group, you're looking at an ischemic optic neuropathy. Look at the visual fields as we just differentiated. And look at the past history. There must be a history of recurrent episodes in the same eye, which were painful, then it is optic neuritis. But if there is a no past history of an episode in the same eye, but maybe a similar episode in the other eye, then you're looking at, and with a patient who had no recovery or partial recovery, then you're looking at an ischemic optic neuropathy. Then look at whether the patient has diabetes, hypertension, other vasculopathic factors. If he has all those things, then you're thinking in terms of ischemic optic neuropathy. Another example, now you can see again, so such a severe disc edema. The first thing that you might think and jump to is, oh, this is raised intracranial pressure. No, it is not. This case, patient had only unilateral disc edema, had only unilateral symptoms, had a RAPD in this eye, had 6x6 division, had severe disc edema like this. And this was unilateral optic neuritis or papillitis. Okay, so what is the investigation of choice when you see a patient of optic neuritis apart from the visual fields and OCT? Divya or Isha?
Color vision.
Oh yeah, OPD, you need to do the color vision, correct. So differentiate optic neuritis, there will be a profound loss of color vision if the patient is able to read the plates with maybe better than 6x60. And if he has severe color vision loss in that eye compared to the other eye, then it is definitely optic neuritis. Okay, then you do a fields, then you do an OCT, and then what next? You are sure it is optic neuritis. Now what next? Which investigation will you do?
Electrophysiology,
blood test. Blood test, yes. Electrophysiology or VEP, yes. For exam sake, for theoretical purposes, yes. VEP tells you, what does it tell you?
So there will be prolonged latency in neurological lesions, whereas amplitude would be reduced in cases of ischemic lesions.
Yes, so prolonged latency in case of inflammatory lesion, where there is a delayed conduction because of demyelination. And in cases of ischemic optic neuropathy, the amplitude is reduced. Okay, now that test is reserved for later. The reason being that not everybody has access to a VEP. So you can do that to complement your diagnosis because it is not going to really help you in treatment. It is an investigation which can be done later. Now, before that, if a patient has a painful blurring of vision, 6x60 with this kind of disc edema, visual field is showing a large central scotoma, and you have, and the OCT confirms this disc edema, now you know it is optic neuritis. So what is the next important investigation that you have to do apart from blood tests and all?
So B scan.
You don't need a B scan. What do you need to do? Which condition is optic neuritis associated with?
MRI.
Yeah, exactly. So you need to do a brain
MRI. Demyelinating
optic. Yeah, brain MRI and orbital MRI with contrast. Okay. Now, why is this required? Because what do you see here? What are these findings called?
Dawson's fingers.
Yes, they are called Dawson's fingers. They are just adjacent to the ventricle and the perpendicular to it. Correct. And these are hyper intense on MRI with contrast. And these lesions can be found anywhere in the brain. There could be many more multiple lesions like this. These are suggestive of demyelination. Right. So this confirms a case of multiple sclerosis. And these days, you have a couple of blood tests which need to be done. What are those in case of optic neuritis of this kind, especially? Which antibodies are you looking for?
We can do the antibodies that is aquaporin 4 to rule out Devic's disease and
yes,
emoji, I mean.
Yes, correct. So you're looking at these two conditions also, because now you have to classify the etiology of optic neuritis. Okay. It's no longer just multiple sclerosis. You have to classify. These are other conditions which have to be ruled out. Okay. So, okay. Now what is this condition? We spoke about this a while earlier.
Neuroretinitis.
Yes. So why do you think it is neuroretinitis?
Because there's involvement of the optic disc as well as there's a macula. I mean, there's a macular involvement in the form of a macular star.
Correct. It's a total complete macular star, right? So, which means there is inflammation on the disc along with inflammation along this entire nerve fiber layer area, and that is why neuroretinitis, and that is causing this kind of exudate all over the macula. And you, what are the conditions associated with neuroretinitis?
One of them being syphilis.
Okay. Anybody can
list out? Cat scratch disease.
Sorry, what? Yeah, cat scratch disease, then?
Bartonella.
Okay, so what you are listing out right now are some of the rarer conditions in India. Tell me the most common conditions.
Tubercular
causing neuroretinitis is also not very common, but which is much more common. Which are the other two infections? Okay, Toxoplasma, Toxocara. Okay. So keep all these conditions in mind when you're looking at a picture like this. And this is definitely not associated with multiple sclerosis. That is an important MCQ question. Okay. Because it is an inflammation located only at the optic nerve disc and in the retina, not related to the brain directly in any way. Okay. So now what is this condition? You have disc edema, of course, and you have, is it hyperemic? Yes or no? Okay, anyway, this is a little doubtful here. So I'll tell you what it is. It's got a little bit of a pallor. This disc edema is not exactly very hyperemic. But this is a young patient and emaciated, has a diet problem. And if you look at the rest of the fundus, you might find a few hemorrhages here and there with some dots on them. And
Nutritional, yes.
Actually, he was anemic. He was severely anemic. So that can also cause this kind of a... He ended up with ischemia, basically. This is a kind of ischemia, but he had anemia as the underlying cause. What is this? Okay, patient had 6x18 vision. And this is the fundus picture. He had a RAPD in this eye. The other eye was normal. Yeah, anybody?
This man.
Yes, Isha.
So it looks like a sectoral,
yes, you're right.
Hyperemia.
Correct.
So it's most likely non-arthritic ischemic optic neuropathy.
Excellent. So this is basically... you can see this luxury perfusion of one half of the disc and the other half looks pale. So this is the affected area, which is ischemic. And because of that, the patient will have this kind of an altitudinal scotoma. And you can see the fundus picture and you can see the red free picture, how it is showing the difference between the upper and the lower half. And this is due to the segmental circulation of the optic nerve behind it, right? So this is NAION. And in NAION, please look at the other eye. Look at the other eye and optic disc. This is a normal optic disc on the other side, but there is hardly any cup. So this suggests a small crowded disc, which is at risk for developing ischemic optic neuropathy in a patient with vasculopathic factors. Okay. Right. So this is also another example of a disc at risk. It is just a congenital crowded disc, no cup, and these crowded vessels. And this is prone to develop ischemic optic neuropathy if the patient has vasculopathic factors or other factors like nocturnal hypotension, or patient has sleep apnea. Such cases can end up with ischemic optic neuropathy in this disc at risk. So this is another example of a patient who had an AION in the right eye 1 year ago, but the vision recovered to 6/5. Now he has acute ischemic optic neuropathy in the left eye, which also on long-term follow-up improved, because both eyes tend to behave similarly, if not the same. Okay, coming to this, now you have a pale disc edema, right? With some amount of pallor extending right into the retina. So the angiography is showing you this choroidal ischemia also. If I tell you this is a 70-year-old with a sudden profound visual impairment in the right eye, with counting fingers vision, but no pain, what are we looking at?
AION, sir, arteritic.
Yes, we are looking at arteritic AION because of the extreme choroidal ischemia along with the optic nerve head ischemia, and elderly patient, painless loss of vision and profound visual impairment. You see how important the history is, and also the ancillary investigation. Okay, another example of a pale disc edema. You can see that, you know, when you get a pale disc edema, now this is very important. A lot of people make this mistake that when they see a case of AION, they are biased. And then when they write the findings, they say there is a disc edema with pallor. Well, non-arteritic AION does not present in the first 2 to 3 weeks with pallor. It presents with hyperemia, if at all anything. By the 3rd to 4th week, it will develop pallor. Whereas the arteritic kind of AION will present with painless visual loss and a pallor along with the disc edema. So pallor is key in arteritic AION, and rarely, as I told you, that case of anemic ischemic optic neuropathy where there was pallor. Okay, not typical in AION. Another example of AION where you have multiple pathologies in the eye. You have the disc edema, pale disc edema with hemorrhages, and you also have a central retinal artery occlusion. Similarly, one more case here, you with the same case, the other eye, you can see there's a few days ago, or maybe a few months ago or a month ago, the patient would have had a sudden loss of vision in the other eye with disc pallor and with central retinal artery occlusion. This is a severe case of ischemic optic neuropathy and ischemic retinopathy. So this definitely goes in favor of an arteritis causing this kind of a pathology. All right. Anybody? Disc edema associated with all these findings. What do you think it is? Now you're looking at the periphery.
Hypertensive retinopathy.
Okay, now be careful here. Yes, you could think in terms of hypertensive retinopathy, but look at the absence of the big cotton wool spots which you saw in the last to last situation. You don't have so many. These are a few artifacts. You don't have so many of those cotton wool spots. What you really have is plenty of hemorrhages all over the place. If you look at all these peripheral areas, you have plenty of hemorrhages all over the place with some amount of disc edema, tortuosity of veins, so much of tortuosity of veins. So what are we looking at? No one? Okay, I'll give you the history. The patient had painless vision loss, and the vision was just 3/60. If you look at the fovea, it's really bad. There was macular edema.
Is it proliferative diabetic retinopathy with
diabetes? Okay, yeah. I know it seems to look like that. Okay, but there was no proliferation here. There were these arterioles also seem to be slightly attenuated. So basically, this patient had a central retinal vein occlusion, a sudden painless loss of vision and severe loss of vision. Okay, so in this kind of a situation, the pathology is retinal and not optic nerve, and it requires all attention towards the retinal treatment. Okay, another example now, there is a disc edema, definitely severe disc edema with hemorrhages all over the place, but all this suggests what?
Heart exudates.
Yes, there are heart exudates, then?
Dot blood hemorrhages.
Dot and blood hemorrhages, yes.
Flame-shaped hemorrhages.
Okay, these are flame-shaped hemorrhages. So what is this? Which condition are we looking at? And if, yes?
CRV also.
Okay, no. So if I tell you that similar condition, this kind of these findings within the circles, the similar findings are there on the other eye also. There's no disc edema on the other eye.
Diabetic retinopathy.
Yes, it is diabetic retinopathy. Right. So that's the importance of looking at the entire fundus before you conclude what this disc edema is. So this patient had an AIOL because that diabetes was the risk factor for the left eye. And associated diabetic retinopathy. Okay. This is an example of papillopathy. The reason being, this patient did not have any severe loss of vision. He had disc edema. He had diabetic retinopathy. He had plenty of hemorrhages, dot and blot hemorrhages all around. And he had a bit of macular edema. And he had disc edema, blurred disc margins all around. But his vision was 6/9. And he hardly had any field defects. Okay, so that is the clue that this is the diabetes, which is playing around with his optic disc and causing ischemia, but not sufficient to damage the optic nerve head, not causing critical loss of vision. So diabetic papillopathy is at one extreme or one spectrum of, one end of the spectrum of ischemic optic neuropathy. It can resolve spontaneously over the next 6 to 8 weeks, provided the diabetic and vasculopathic factors are kept under good control.
So the only differentiating factor would be a visual field, sir, between diabetic papillopathy.
Yeah, both vision and visual fields. And the papillopathy can be bilateral, and so with hardly any visual loss, and such cases usually improve with time. So all these are in favor of papillopathy. Okay. Now, this is another case, the diagnosis is already given there. You can see there's vasculitis. And there are so many exudates here. This vasculitis is adjacent to the disc here. So there is disc edema on this margin of the disc. And so what this tells you is that you can have uveitis, retinitis, vasculitis associated with disc edema, but there will not be any optic nerve function loss because the main pathology is retinal or choroidal or vascular, not on the disc. All right. So that is the clue that this is more of a uveitis rather than a optic neuritis, or it is just an associated optic nerve head swelling. Okay, what is this in the same vein? I was talking about uveitis. What could this be? So patient had, let's say something like 6/18 vision in both the eyes, sudden loss of vision, there is some amount of retinal detachment. That's the clue.
So, retinal necrosis.
No, necrosis.
Exudative detachment. That's what he said.
Yeah, exudative detachment. That's what I was talking about. Some amount of exudative detachment. And I told you uveitis, so that's the clue. Bilateral disc edema. Fundus doesn't look orange like it normally does, right? So what is it?
Patient had deafness also.
Okay, yeah. Yes?
PKH.
VKH, yes, exactly. This is a Vogt-Koyanagi-Harada syndrome, where you can see that basically this disc edema is not the cause for vision loss. It is more of the retinal detachment which causes the vision loss, and the edema all around, and that is causing this kind of appearance of the disc, optic disc. Okay, so that is one thing. Then what are these? Somebody mentioned this.
Patton lines.
So Patton's lines are generally multiple lines. They are circumferential, peripapillary, and that is because of the extension of edema into the retinal layers, which is what you see, looks like Patton's lines. And when they, the disc edema resolves and these lines and the edema recedes, goes back, then you see these left behind as watermarks. Okay. Now, yeah, this was a patient who had severe disc edema, but it is a chronic disc edema, unilateral, and no hemorrhages, exudates all around it. So basically, it's a kind of a chronic disc edema in this patient who has an optic nerve sheath meningioma. So you can see this is a compressive disc edema. There is severe compression by this lesion causing disc edema, which was persistent. I saw her over a number of years and it just remained the same. Fortunately, with no ischemia setting in or no pallor of the disc, and vision was around 618 or something and maintained at that. Okay. Now, this is a rare condition. Okay. As we had graded the edema earlier, this is a severe edema. But what are these? What exactly is this? What are these? This, the arrows which are pointing towards, what are all these?
Sir, sclerosed vessels.
No. Anybody else? Any other guess?
Any plaques.
This eye had no PL. Okay. This eye had no PL. There's something else. Now I'm giving you the clue. Just look at this underlying thing here. You see this whole, this orangish, yellowish underlying thing.
A mass.
Okay, so this is not a mass, but yes, it is a kind of an infiltrate. Okay, so something is infiltrating this optic nerve head, and it has produced with all this kind of yellowish, dirty looking infiltrates on the surface as well as all around the peripapillary region. No PL, patient of leukemia. Okay, this is leukemic infiltrative optic neuropathy. Okay, again, rare condition, but those who do a lot of trabeculectomies will be very familiar with this. When there is a sharp drop in the intraocular pressure post trabeculectomy, the eyes 2 mm, 3 mm of mercury, then you can have this kind of complication, which is a disc edema with a macular, hypotony causing a macular fold, which you can see here. And this is basically hypotony maculopathy with disc edema. This is mechanical. So this is again, the disc is not going to cause any visual problems here. This is mechanical. It may resolve with the correction of the intraocular pressure. So I was telling you that those Patton's lines, and the entire fluid has receded. The disc edema is almost gone. And what are you left with now? All around the disc are watermarks. These are watermarks. Okay, so the OCT. Now the OCT basically helps you to look at so many things. This is a normal optic nerve head with a cup. This is showing a certain amount of elevation. It's actually a crowded disc. Then you see the edema. See how the disc is elevated, but what you see here, what they have listed out, and this is from a book. So what it has listed out is optic disc drusen. These are the drusen that you see and the shadows under the drusen. Then you have a true disc edema. Then you have this mild, moderate, severe disc edema. And these are cases of very severe disc edema. So this is the clinical picture, the OCT picture, and the follow-up of these cases to look for resolution of the disc edema. Nowadays, you have the OCT angiography. That is another advancement. And basically, it helps you to look at every single section from the optic nerve head surface down deep into lamina quebrosa, and you can see the vasculature of the entire optic nerve head. This helps you in some cases to differentiate between ischemic optic neuropathy and optic neuritis, or papillary edema and ischemic optic neuropathy. So this is still to develop, but it is now being extensively used wherever it's available to scan the optic nerve head. Okay. So in summary, we are back to all those things which I mentioned earlier, and just recap this. Always take a detailed history, check for RAPD, study the morphology of the disc, do the visual fields, OCT imaging, FFA if required, because it's an invasive test, do the systemic investigations and the blood pressure check, don't forget that, and come to the diagnosis. Now coming to the second part of my talk, which is much shorter, but nevertheless, not less important. It consider all the disc pallors just like an optic neuropathy which happened 4 weeks back. Okay, so never look at a disc pallor thinking, oh, this eye has poor vision, has disc pallor, so nothing can be done and forget it. No, that's not the way of looking at disc pallor. Look at it from the point of view of what is the lesion, where is the lesion, why did this happen, when did this happen. So the end stage of any optic neuropathy, if left untreated, will look like this, will look like a disc pallor. But you have to differentiate between the causes of the optic neuropathy, the etiology of the optic neuropathy, and the kind of presentation that it has given you. So now let's see, this is a bilateral disc edema which is resolving, and there is some amount of pallor that has set in. So you can have, this could be a post-papilledemic disc pallor. That means it was a long-standing disc pallor and now it is ending up with optic nerve head pallor. Okay. So optic disc pallor. Now disc pallor versus optic atrophy. What is known is that 40 to 60% of mild to moderate disc pallor patients will have good vision in that eye. And 33% of severe disc pallor can still have good vision. Whereas optic atrophy, so use the word optic atrophy when it means a loss of nerve fibers in an advanced optic nerve disease with visual loss or visual field loss. So you understand the difference. Don't use the term optic atrophy all the time. You can mention disc pallor for every disc pallor, but don't use the word optic atrophy until and unless there is a certain amount of visual loss or visual field loss. So the clinical classification is there in the book, but primary is any pathology which is behind, which is not on the optic nerve head surface, is not in the retina, it's something behind which is directly compressing the optic nerve or causing a disc pallor due to compression or ischemia. Secondary is when there is a pathology which is visible or which is on the surface or on the optic nerve head, like a papillary edema and ischemic optic neuropathy, optic neuritis, which can present later on with a grayish white blurred margin. So that will basically be a secondary optic disc pallor or atrophy. And consecutive is consecutive to severe or extensive retinal disease like RP or extensive PRP or a total retinal long-standing retinal detachment. And glaucomatous, we all know, is with advanced cupping. So now we know the entire list of etiology of optic disc pallor. I'm not going to that. So somebody described this. This is the right eye and the left eye of the same patient who had, okay, I'll not tell you the etiology. Just describe this disc. Anyone?
So with the clear media, the disc margins appear to be normal, and the color of the disc looks a little pale, and the cup disc ratio is not clearly made out, and the vessels arising from the disc are central, but the veins appear slightly tortuous on the right eye.
Yes. So I would say, or anyone would describe this as significant disc color compared to the other. Okay, so all your evaluations are in comparison to the other eye. So if you look at that hyper, the normal color of the optic disc in the left eye, this disc is significantly pale. almost so it is like a chalky white disc. Okay, so this is a primary optic atrophy because the vision had vision was only PLPR, and the patient had a head trauma followed by vision loss, followed by this kind of disc 4 weeks later. Many people mention the disc pallor on presentation 2 days after trauma. No, it doesn't happen so fast. The disc becomes pale only 3 to 4 weeks later. So don't write pale disc in a case of traumatic optic neuropathy, which happened just 2 days back or a week back. Okay. Now coming to the next thing. So this is again similar picture of primary optic atrophy. This is the picture I showed you earlier of AION. This is secondary because the disc is not chalky white, it's something like dirty white. It's not exactly white all over. It's doesn't have a very clear margin like the primary case. This has got a secondary optic atrophy. And this eye, of course, will end up in the same picture 4 to 6 weeks later. This is again another example of a secondary optic atrophy. You see the disc has got this kind of dirty grayish appearance. Margins are not very clear. The vessels are attenuated. So all this tells you that the pathology or the etiology is right on the disc. And so maybe he had an ischemic optic neuropathy, or he probably had optic neuritis. Now that will be differentiated by the history and by the investigations. As I told you earlier, you'll do the same field tests, you'll do the same, you'll take same detailed history and arrive at the conclusion. Okay. As in this case, the other eye is okay, but this eye has gotten almost near altitudinal scotoma, inferior altitudinal, suggestive of an ischemic optic neuropathy, especially along with this because of these attenuated arterioles. Then all these patterns which I told you, just remember them when you have a case of a disc pallor, do the visual fields. If you get any of these patterns, then correlate with the etiology. This is a case of, again, you can see that there's severe disc pallor. This happens because of the gross ischemia, which is seen in such patients of giant cell arteritis. Altitudinal. Now here you can see sectoral disc pallor. So as you had as rightly mentioned, the term is called sectoral involvement of the disc with, because the superior half is ischemic, the lower half has inferior altitudinal scotoma. And this is another case of a pale disc edema. So this is a disc edema which is going into optic disc pallor. Okay, now you have a case with, let's say 636 vision in both the eyes. Okay, can you list all the etiologies? Anyone? Yes, Sony?
Nutritional optic neuropathy.
Nutritional, very good. Then?
Toxic optic neuropathy.
Toxic optic neuropathy, then?
Glaucoma.
No. Please don't bring that here. Glaucoma does not primarily have disc pallor. Okay. This is not cupping. This is disc pallor. So, okay. Nutritional, toxic, then?
Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy.
Very good. Hereditary optic neuropathy. What is the most common bilateral temporal disc pallor due to?
So dominant optic atrophy.
Okay, fine. That's also got some hereditary component to it. What I'm talking about here is a youngster, 20, 25 year old with recurrent painful visual loss. And then you see her after say 10 years of recurrent episodes. And this is the fundus picture. So you see everything is in the history. I told you, young girl who had recurrent bilateral visual loss, and I'm not saying she's paraplegic. I'm just talking about the visual problem here. And
IIH, sir.
Okay.
IIH, sir.
Now you've raised a controversy here. So this is not IIH. I told you painful. So IIH will not have pain in the eyes. 2
MS.
This is temporal disc pallor. If your IIH leads to this kind of disc pallor, then something is wrong in your diagnosis. This is, the rest of the disc is healthy, if you can see. You see that nasal side and the superior inferior seem all right. It's only temporal pallor. I told you it's a young female with painful episodes of loss of vision. So now you're thinking of MS, and I would like you to, in whenever you ask such a question, please mention about the optic disc diagnosis first, and then talk about the etiology behind it. So this is a recurrent optic neuritis. Okay, whether it was papillitis or retrobulbar neuritis, but this is recurrent optic neuritis leading to this kind. So it is clinically known as post-neuritic disc pallor. And if the vision is, as I told you, something like 636 or something, then it is post-neuritic optic atrophy. Okay. And as you said, the associated condition could be MS because it was recurrent, and maybe she had multiple demyelinating lesions in the brain, and she may or may not have had complete treatment for it. And then she develops motor symptoms and could become paraplegic. So this kind of a picture has so many etiologies behind it. You have to go into the history to get what it is. Whether there is a family history of disc pallor or loss of vision due to optic nerve disease, or whether there is a person who is trying to lose weight and so is not having enough nutrition, or a person who is smoking too much and or taking alcohol a lot, or a person who has, taken ethambutol for tuberculosis, treatment of tuberculosis. So all these could present with a picture like this. Okay. Then this is a different case. Now, oh yes, okay. Why did I keep this here? This was just to confuse you. What are these bitemporal defects suggestive of?
Chiasmatic lesions.
Sorry, didn't get you.
Chiasmatic lesions.
Yeah, chiasmatic lesion. Correct. So crossing nasal fibers get compressed, and that causes bitemporal defects. And that is a picture of pituitary macroadenoma, which was causing the optic chiasmal compression. But the thing is, this is not the most common present cause or etiology of temporal disc pallor. So don't confuse it with this. But I'm just giving you the importance of doing the visual fields. So even if it is 636 vision, take the size 5 target and do the visual fields so that you can get a pattern out of it, which can give you a clue to where the lesion is. Okay. This is another, that last case we saw hypertensive and can go on if uncontrolled to present like this. So the vision recovered, but you can see that there is arteriolar attenuation, there is disc pallor, exudates are resolving. And so this is a dirty looking disc because of the edema on the disc surface. The problem was in the disc and the peripapillary area, not behind. So this is a secondary disc pallor, secondary optic atrophy. And this is a post-papilledemic optic atrophy, or you can call it a post-papilledemic optic disc pallor on both sides. You see the watermarks and you see some amount of disc pallor in both the eyes. Then you see this dirty picture around here. So that means the fluid had been all up to here. You see the dirty gray appearance. So this is a secondary disc pallor in a case with a cerebellar astrocytoma. Another example of a secondary optic atrophy with a constricted visual field. So these are residual defects or problems associated with that. Now you have a patient who has unilateral disc pallor with a total ophthalmoplegia and a lesion at the orbital apex compressing the optic nerve in the canal. What do you think is this lesion? Anyone? Or is it mentioned there? Middle-aged female, unilateral lesion, which on a CT scan seems to be showing
meningioma.
It's a meningioma, that's right. And so in a meningioma, you have, what is this? Can you make out the arrow? What is this? What is it called? Disc pallor due to meningioma with optociliary
shunts.
Yeah, you see a classic presentation, optociliary shunts in a patient with a optic nerve sheath meningioma with disc pallor. That was the primary reason to show you this disc pallor, because it's a long-standing condition. Okay, coming to consecutive optic disc atrophy or optic disc pallor is because of extensive retinal disease, and then the patient had extensive laser PRP all around, and that leads to a certain amount of pallor of the optic disc. So the clue is here in the retina. So it is a consecutive optic atrophy. If the fovea is good, then the patient may have 6-6 vision, but with this kind of a picture of the disc. Another example where this patient had extensive retinal, you know, multiple central serous retinopathy, recurrent presentations. And then you had this kind of a dirty looking retina both sides. And then the patient had some arteriolar attenuation. So this was a extensive retinal disease followed by some amount of disc pallor. Okay. Interesting thing here is, looks like disc pallor, but be careful on the photographs. It will look like this due to artifacts. So it's your clinical examination which is more important, whether it shows the disc pallor or not. But what is happening here in this case is that from this arrow till this arrow, you can see the entire area, the nerve fiber layer is missing. There's a defect. So this is glaucomatous cupping. You see, it looks as if it is pallor, but actually if you look carefully, the nerve fiber layer here is gone. The neuroretinal rim is gone. The nerve fiber layer is gone. So this is that. So finally, in every case of optic disc pallor where there is no clear-cut diagnosis, please do the Humphrey visual field test, which is a magic tool, leads you to the cause. Specifically, if you're looking for other reasons, you can tailor make this to, for example, do a VEP if you're looking for recurrent optic neuritis, and do a Doppler ultrasound or the blood sugars if you're looking for ischemia, do the blood pressure if you're thinking of hypertensive retinopathy, do the neuroimaging if you're looking for a compressive lesion or intracranial space occupying lesion or optic nerve lesion, which is compressive in nature. Okay, let's go to questions.
Hello, sir.
Yes, Rolika.
Sir, I think that you have covered all the doubts that one could have. In fact, like I think Divya, Anisha, Sony, and Abhinav, everybody has interacted so very well, and they have made this particular episode very interactive, and I think that answers all the questions that all the PGs would have in mind.
Yeah, so there were two questions which had come up earlier. One was to tell us the technique to examine the spontaneous venous pulsation and how not to miss it. So basically it is said that seems that 80% of the population has it, but practically speaking, with the amount of time that you spend with each patient, it's not possible to find it in every single patient. But so what you do is that if you're actually looking for it in a case of disc edema, first thing, you should have seen it earlier in normal patients with normal discs. And when it is there, significantly pulsating, you cannot miss it. Whether you're looking at it with an indirect or a direct or a 9 or whatever you look at it with, but it's better to look at it with a 78 or a 90D, because with the magnified view, you will see the pulsation much more better. And you have to look at one of the main veins right on the disc near the cup or on the cup, and you can see one or two of those veins pulsating. Then if you are keen to elicit it, then it is suggested to compress the eye, using the depressor so that you can kind of create a differential which will cause the vein to pulsate. And So that is the method to look for it. But once you have seen a certain number of pulsating spontaneous vein pulsations of the optic disc, then you won't miss it when you're looking for it in a case of papilledema, a suspected papilledema.
Right, sir.
Yeah. And the other question was about how to comment on the grade of RAPD clinically without using the ND filter. Now, the ND filter is not available with anybody, for that matter, practically speaking. So what we do is we look for the RAPD in a dark room, ask the patient to look at a target in the distance, which should not be a reading target, because if he starts reading, then he'll focus and he'll cause accommodation and all those things. So try to give him the largest letter on the chart so that he can just not try to focus, he can just look at it straight. Ask him not to strain too much on trying to read or anything. Bring the torch from below, not from front of the patient, because that would cause the patient to, it will cause meiosis. So don't do that. Just bring it from below and take it on one eye at a time and swing it quickly across the bridge of the nose. But wait on the eye for 3 to 5 seconds. Then swing it across within 2 seconds to the other eye. Again, wait for 3 to 5 seconds, because the response comes within the next 2 to 3 seconds. So just wait for that. And when you find that both the pupils are not staying the same size, do this repeatedly. And if you find the pupils are not exactly staying the same size, one of them is escaping or one of them has not constricted well, so then you know that there is RAPD. Now, when you see that, do it 3, 4 times more. So if there is a pupil which escapes immediately, then you are looking at a grade 3 to 4 RAPD and correlate it with the vision. So what I always do is correlate it with the vision. So if you've gotten 6x6 both eyes and you get a RAPD, then generally it would be 1 to 2+ RAPD. But if you've got a counting fingers vision or PLPR vision and you get a RAPD in one eye, then it's going to be a 3 to 4+ RAPD. So correlate it with that. And if you have a bilateral optic neuropathy, then you may not get a RAPD. Both eyes may be sluggish, so there'll be a bilateral APD. So both may not react well to direct light, but when you go from one eye to the other eye, you might find no difference, nothing changing, because both eyes are equally affected. But the pupils may be a little dilated, and may not be 3 mm, maybe a 3.5, 4 mm, and they may not be reacting very well. Is that okay?
So may I ask one last question, sir?
Yes, sure.
Sir, may I know the color vision, if it will be impaired in case of even nutritional and optic neuropathy, sir, or toxic optic neuropathy or drug induced, will the color vision still be impaired?
So now the color vision, very interesting. So first of all, if it is a female, you do not expect any congenital color vision blindness, right? So first thing is you've got to rule out, if it's a male, 8% will have a congenital color vision anomaly. So why I'm starting with that is because many a times we assume that everybody is normal unless proved otherwise, but 8% of males already have a color vision problem, right? So if you have a male who has a nutritional optic neuropathy or a hereditary or whatever it is, first be very sure, ask him the history. Did he have proper color vision since childhood or not? So that is one thing. Second is when you look at the amount of color vision deficiency and ask them to read the Ishihara plates, and then if they are unable to read most of the plates in one eye, whichever has the optic neuropathy, it is an optic neuritis, it is inflammatory, because the color vision loss is out of proportion to the visual loss in optic neuritis. But coming to your question, whether all the other optic neuropathies like hereditary and nutritional will have color vision, they can have. There's no rule which says they cannot have color vision loss, because there is an optic neuropathy after all. So they may have, they may not be able to read a few plates on the color vision charts, but not as significant as we have in inflammatory optic neuropathy.
So the way you remember it is that the disorders which will produce sequocentral scotoma, or if the patient in these disorders have sequocentral scotoma, what it tells you is that papillomacular bundle are predominantly affected by the pathology. Remember, papillomacular bundle carry the cones, the fibers from cones to the macula to the optic disc, which are predominantly cones. So if these diseases have sequocentral scotoma, and you probably will see, as Satya said, color vision deficit to be significant. Same patients have only central scotoma. The papillomacular bundle are not as damaged as the other patients. You will say that, yeah, you will have a color vision deficit. You will surely have color vision deficit, but not as significant as the patient. So the, another prime example, apart from nutritional and toxic, what you talked about, the third example of disease in this category would be LHON. Is that the other disease which will cause supracentral scotoma? And you may find that the color vision deficit to be significant. And remember, other point which Satya very beautifully made, you have to remember in LHON that most of these, almost all patients will be male. So first you have to make sure that before you give color vision and associated with LHON, make sure that one way to differentiate is to use a red filter. A lot of these congenital color vision candidates would have some improvement in the color vision when you put a red filter.
Yeah. Achha, one more thing is that, for practical reasons, so if a patient has 636 or better vision, he may read the plates for you, but if you are not putting on his reading glasses, and if he has a poor central vision, he has 6x60, he just can't see the plates in the first place to read your color vision plates, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. So
just remember that when you're doing it practically. You don't say there is that the color vision is poor. You say that he just can't see the plates. So in that case, even that 12 will not be seen. The first plate will also not be seen.
Very important point.
Same thing goes for fields, visual fields. So if the vision is less than 6x60, then I did say use size 5 target, but then those 3x60 patients may not see the dome at all properly. So how will they even respond to any stimulus? So that is one thing. You can say the test was not possible because the patient could not appreciate the stimuli at all or the central fixation target at all.
Great. Any other questions from Isha? Do you want to ask anything?
Sir, I actually wanted to ask about the mechanism of bow tie optic atrophy in compressive lesions.
Not compression. Compression only at the chiasm.
Yeah.
So what kind of field effect do you get if you have an optic chiasm problem?
Bitemporal hemianopia.
Right. So bitemporal hemianopia, temporal visual field are served by what fibers in the retina?
Nasal
to what?
Nasal to the fovea.
Nasal to fovea, exactly right. Nasal to fovea are the nasal fibers which serve the temporal field. Temporal to fovea, they go in an arcuate way, right? And those fibers are affected first in glaucoma. So that's the reason why in glaucoma you get superior and inferior defects first. While the fibers which are nasal to macula, they go and attach like this to the optic disc. And they are gone in chiasmal compression. And that's the reason why superior and inferior poles, the arcuate fibers are still working. So the poles are still pink, while these are gone. They become pale. And that's the reason why there is a band shape or a bow tie optic atrophy. Right, Sita, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, actually, just wanted to say that recently had a patient who had, basically an intracranial tumor and chiasmal compression. And on fundus examination seemed to have temporal pallor, and the OCT showed temporal thinning, temporal fiber thinning on the disc, temporal on the disc, right? Okay. So but his vision was quite good and he underwent surgery. So closely related to the question that you asked. So the bow tie is basically on the horizontal axis. And that is something which you need to remember. The neurological lesions, in terms of visual fields, they will chiasmal, post-chiasmal will respect the vertical meridian, but on the disc, the findings will respect the horizontal meridian.
Thank you, sir.
If there are no further questions, then I would like to profusely thank Satyakarna on behalf of the iFocus team for sparing his time and giving a wonderful lecture. You covered everything in great detail and with a lot of illustration. So thank you so much. And I thank Divya, Isha, Sony, and everybody who joined in for Hot Seat. Please remember the next week, Wednesday, we have only cases. Dr. Himalini Samant will join us from Mumbai. And we have only case discussion. So please also tell your friends to participate in Hot Seat because it will be important. Those cases. To revise it and also discuss with the faculty. So till then, see you all. Good night. Thank you, Satya.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure. Good night.